Good evening. Welcome to the museum at MFIT's Fashion Culture Series. This event is organized by the museum at MFIT and by MFIT's Gladys Marcus Library. Tonight it is our pleasure to have visual artists Natalie Frank and Kirsty Mitchell. They are joined by Colleen Hill, curator of the MFIT exhibition Fairytale Fashion. Originally from Austin, Texas, Natalie Frank has an MFA in visual arts from Columbia University. Frank's recent exhibition, The Brothers Grimm, featured 25 chalk and pastel drawings. In this work, Frank applies her visual and psychological insight to fairy tales, one of the most suggestive and misunderstood literary forms. Kirsty Mitchell began her higher education at 16, studying fine art, photography, and history of art. At 19, she specialized in costume for performance at the London College of Fashion. She went on to train at Ravensbourne College of Art, and after graduating from school, she worked as a fashion designer. Later, she immersed herself into photography following her mother's death and created Wonderland, which combines dreamlike photographs, literature, and personal meditations. Colleen Hill's exhibition, Fairytale Fashion, examines fairy tales through the lens of high fashion. Please join me in welcoming Colleen Hill, Natalie Frank, and Kirsty Mitchell.
Hi, everyone. Welcome. I'm Colleen Hill. As Tanya said, I'm the curator of Fairytale Fashion, and I'm very excited to have Natalie and Kirsty here this evening. Before we talk more specifically about their work, I did want to give a really brief introduction to the importance of fairy tale imagery in the way that I put together my exhibition. Because, of course, I was basing my work off of literary texts, really the second thing I did was explore how illustrators had shown these characters, had of course shown their dress, but also really created a setting for fairy tales. And you'll see I ended up including in our introductory space in the gallery, which you see here, one illustration to show each of the 15 tales that I represent in the exhibition. Many of these are by well-known illustrators, usually dating to the late 19th and early 20th centuries. And there's another shot of some of them a little bit closer. And you see in the case there are also some early fairy tale books as well as some more contemporary fairy tale editorials that inspired my work. And then here I'll just quickly go through some more specific illustrations, some of which I used in the exhibition, but others that were just a little bit more inspiring to me. So you start to see fairy tales really being illustrated during the 19th century. And so, for example, Little Red Riding Hood begins to wear what's actually this kind of hooded cloak during this time period. Natalie will probably talk a little bit later about how she's originally called Little Red Cap, so it actually changes from a cap to a cloak really based on a real fashion item. And Arthur Rackham was one of the illustrators that I think is very inspirational to many people, certainly not just me. He's incredibly well known. This is Cinderella in her rags. I think one of the most romantic and beautiful images of Cinderella in her tattered dress. And another Rackham illustration that I included, this is not in the exhibition, but rather in the book, solely because I think this one has a little bit more of a sinister feel, and as you'll see, some of Natalie's work has that feel as well, so I wanted to bring some of that in. A great Kai Nielsen illustration of Rapunzel. This is hand-colored from the New York Public Library. Another beautiful Kai Nielsen, you can see the level of detail that he put into his work and often into the fashion pieces. Some Edmond Dulac, an early Beauty and the Beast, and the Snow Queen. And you still see a lot of this illustration in particular has made quite an impact on a lot of fashion editorials and current images related to the Snow Queen. And then one of my favorites, A.H. Watson, who illustrated the mean stepsisters in Cinderella. In the version of the tale by Charles Perrault that I reference in the exhibition, the stepsisters are actually meant to be fashionable. They're not meant to be ugly or ridiculous. They are very mean. But as we often see them illustrated already by the 19th century and certainly into the 20th, they're meant to be kind of ridiculous looking and unfashionable or wearing ill-fitting clothes. This is a lovely Margaret Evans Price, one of the illustrators you don't hear a lot about, but who did bring a lot of really beautiful kind of pastel colors into her work. And then Jenny Harbour, an illustration for The Little Mermaid, someone who's also brought a lot of depth of color that I really love and that I again think relates to both Kirsty's and Natalie's work. So here we have a lovely portrait of Natalie, and I'll begin by saying that while I was working on the Fairy Tale Fashion exhibition, I was alerted to the fact that Natalie had this fantastic exhibition at the Drawing Center, and so I went to see that and was really blown away by the beauty of this imagery, but I think more importantly the fact that both Natalie and I were ignoring the Disney versions of fairy tales and going straight to the source, which tends to be a little bit more macabre and sinister. I bring a little tiny bit of that into the exhibition, but Natalie brings a lot more of that into her work. Yes. So I'm just going to click forward, and these are some images of the installation at the Drawing Center. And this was right around the time that you and I met.
Yes, and right, is this working? Yes, right as the book that I made to also accompany the show was coming out with 75 of these large color drawings and handmade title pages and borders. But in thinking about, one thing that really took me aback in your show, Colleen, was the exhibition design and the way that you created these magical worlds for each of the fairy tales. And we also in the Drawing Center exhibition thought about trying to create this kind of otherworldly space. And so the curator, Claire Gilman, came up with the idea to paint the walls this like rich blue that then became part of the show as it's traveled, which has been really nice.
And I like that you brought that up, because that was one of the things that really struck me about this exhibition, was that bright blue wall, and particularly considering you have so much color in these images, but somehow it really worked. It was really beautiful. And here is the cover of your book. And another thing that kind of brought Natalie and I together was that early in my research for the exhibition, I realized that the real number one scholar of fairy tales is a man named Jack Zipes, and I had emailed him and asked him some questions. He very graciously responded to me, and you have a real personal relationship with Jack, if you could talk about that.
Yeah, I also started out, I wanted to make this Grimm's book and started the drawings about 4 years ago. I'm primarily a painter, so this was my first show of drawings and my first time illustrating tales for a book. Though these are, I thought of the drawings very much as kind of my feminist interpretations of the stories, which, if you all know, the originals are very, very gruesome and have a lot of the realities and brutalities of life in the 19th century in them. But I realized that I needed the translations of the Grimms as they were under copyright. And so I emailed Jack out of the blue and said, "Hi, I'm very eager and I'd like to use your translations and make a book and have the show." And he wrote back again immediately and said, "Anything I can do to help." And he was so gracious, and we became close friends. And so he ended up writing the introduction to my Grimm's book, which has 36 of the tales illustrated from the 1812 to 1857 editions. And then he's also sort of advised me about, you know, ordering the tales, because when you work with fairy tales, there are some internal logics that you have to pay attention to. So for instance, in the Brothers Grimm, in every compilation that's made, you begin with the Frog King and end with the Golden Key. So he said, you know, the order's up to you. And I had a lot of fun ordering them, sort of in a, not a similar way, but you try to find some sort of logic to these mysterious worlds. And so I group the tales of you know, parents and children. And then there were a lot of adulty men. So there was kind of like a simpleton section. Animal-human transformations, and sort of tried to group them in that way.
Fantastic. So let's flip through. Whoops. I just did something weird. There we go. And this is from the book as well.
This is Cinderella, and this is her in her golden gown. And it was funny because I was looking. I love fashion, and I've, you know, Alexander McQueen is one of my favorite designers, and So I've sort of, when I was making these, I was gathering imagery from some historical imagery, some sort of interior imagery from like Architectural Digest to kind of find spaces to put these figures in, and looking at a lot of old fairy tale imagery, but also looking at a fair amount of fashion imagery when I was trying to decide how to clothe the heroines of the stories, and especially when something like the golden dress is so important to the story. It became a sort of central character itself, the fashion. But each of the 36 tales, I made a title page and a border for them, which the borders repeat throughout the book.
It's really, really stunning. Thanks.
And then this is the first end paper, and this was all of the heroines on stage in their different costumes. So there's Little Red Cap in the front with the wolf beside her, Rapunzel in the blue dress with the long hair, and Cinderella in the golden gown. And then on the far left is the devil's grandmother, who I decided in true grandmother, I guess, devil fashion, should have an aging devil on her head instead of white hair. So I had a lot of fun really dressing and lighting these characters. So the first in paper are the heroines, and then the next slide is the last in paper, which are the villains. So you see the wolf, donkey from donkey skin, and which is also called all fur, the frog, which is basically just evil in so many stories, and then the devil on the right.
So some of these Grimm Brothers stories, I have to admit, I don't even know well, because when I started working on fairy tale fashion, I very quickly identified the stories that I thought would work best for my point of view. So I think you have actually a much better sense of some of these bizarre, not very well-known Brothers Grimm stories.
Right. Or well-known versions that we don't, that's the beauty of what Jack has really done in bringing us the first edition tales. And he was the first to translate the first edition into English in the late 80s. So it really explains why up until that point we've only had sanitized versions. And the history is interesting because one of the brothers actually sanitized the tales early on to try to increase sales of the book and in hoping that they might resonate with children. And throughout the years, they continued to sanitize them because they are very explosive. And so, for instance, in Frog King, originally, you know, the princess plays with her golden ball. The frog, she loses it. The frog recovers it. She says, "I'll give you anything you want." So he shows up at her door and says, "I want you." And she's like, "Oh, God." And so the father says, "You know, you made a promise. Now you have to obey." And so the next scenes are the frog crawling into bed with the woman, the frog eats with the woman, the frog showers with the woman, he sits on her pillowcase, and eventually, I guess, things escalate. And she throws him against the wall, which is supposed to be a metaphor, and he becomes a prince.
Of course. That happens so often in these tales.
So this is Sleeping Beauty, and this is the Evil Queen. And I thought, what should an evil queen be wearing? Red, naturally. That's my favorite color. But if you look closely, you can see her dress is also made up of a face. So the eyes are on her breasts, and the mouth is on her abdomen. And she's looking at a horrifying reflection of herself.
And I know that you used people that you know often as models. So can you divulge who inspired the wicked Stepmother?
This is a really good friend of mine who's an artist. And really, it's people who are willing to get dressed up and pose for me. But a lot of times I just ask random people, too, who I find striking. It's amazing how many people really want to play out fantasies and be photographed. So it's actually not terribly hard.
So you work off of photographs then? Okay.
Photographs for the people, some of the faces and hands mm-hmm. and eyes. The scenes are put together through imagination and through compilations of pictures of interiors, which I have to use because I don't actually have depth perception. So it's very hard for me to understand space. Mm-hmm. So I use architectural interiors to build those spaces and then really kind of populate them with actors.
And the dwarfs in this case.
And the dwarfs are in the back. And this, I think this one is almost the complete set of Sleeping Beauty, but not quite. The next slide is her in her crystal coffin, and all of the animals come and are in adoration, and they're all crying. And then this is Sleeping Beauty after she's been poisoned by the apple. And she's also wears the poison laces, mm-hmm. which bind her, which probably relates very directly into fashion. I wonder, was that ever, did any of the designers that you worked with or put in the exhibition speak about working from text directly?
No. A lot of what I put in the show was my own interpretation of designer's work. So I had some very interesting emails where I was saying, well, there's this moment in this story and this dress kind of looks like it. So fortunately, I got a very good response, but I did send some really crazy emails to people about why I wanted something in particular.
This is funny. This is a crazy, there's so many transformations between animal and human that almost wearing animal furs and pelts and heads and bodies becomes a type of disguise and clothing. Mm-hmm. And so this is bare skin. And this is a man who's cursed by Satan and sent out to travel the world and can't clean himself, shave, comb his hair, or cut his nails. And basically becomes a bear. And Cinderella. And this is the initial scene when the you see in the back the stepmother dancing with death. And she is told she can go to the ball if she can pick up all the lentil seeds in time. So she calls the birds in, who are often helpers of women throughout the stories.
That's very true. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think that from reading Marina Warner's book, which is really fascinating, From the Beast to the Blonde, focusing especially on representations of women throughout the tales and throughout the 19th century and before that, she talks about that gynecologists often wore this beak-like device when they inspected women in the doctor's office, and thus storks and birds became associated as helpers of women.
Which is so fascinating because I'm sure none of us had any idea where that imagery had come from, but leave it to Marina Warner to tell us. Yeah, and then her beautiful gold dress.
Her golden dress, and the poor prince has to come after her, but I portrayed him naked and headless. And then she hides in a tree. And then the next scene is her kind of really in the golden gown with another bird who's her helper. But the oftentimes kind of the blonde hair and the golden gown and the golden birds all became one, in my mind, one kind of outfit or dress.
Mm-hmm. I like that.
And this is the wedding scene in the end of Cinderella, which a lot of people don't know in the unsanitized version. The princess marries the prince, who I drew as a troll, with the stepsisters in the back having their eyes pecked out by birds.
Yeah, the very harsh
version. And after they tried to self-amputate to try to fit in the slipper.
Right.
So it was not just merely cramming the foot in, being sad and running away.
Yeah, the Brothers Grimm version of Cinderella is very nasty.
This is Juniper Tree. And this is a really funny, very violent story about a woman who can't have a child, prays to the juniper tree to have a child, becomes pregnant, gives birth, dies, and the stepmother takes in the little boy with her daughter, and one day says to the two children, go and look in my little wooden box. And the minute they reach down, she decapitates the little boy. And she tells the daughter, or no, she props the head on the little boy's body, ties it up with a white handkerchief. I mean, it's really interesting, the level of detail and thinking about these stories and fashion, because every detail of clothing is really spelled out and important. So it's a white handkerchief, holds the head on the body, tells her daughter to go poke him. And what do you know? The head rolls off. So the little girl thinks she's killed her half-brother. And then the story goes from there, including culinary delights when the little boy's eaten.
We know why we don't see these in children's anthologies anymore.
But I should say, you know, Jack and Marina Warner and Maria Tatar, one thing that's really interesting that they write about is that these stories are oral tales, so they're handed down through the generations, and primarily were women's stories. So women gathered the oral tales in places that women were, by the well and in the home, and would in the kitchen, and would repeat them. And they were passed down and changed sort of by country and generation, but they really represented women's kind of desires and fears and fantasies mm-hmm. in the 19th century, because all of these things were going on. People, you know, when they didn't have enough food, would actually eat their children, or, you know, they would send their young children out into the woods and they were attacked by animals. It was kind of interesting to reconsider these tales within their context.
Yeah, I had a conversation with someone this morning about fairy tales, and she was saying that she has a young daughter and she wouldn't let her daughter watch the Cinderella movie because she doesn't want her daughter to think that, you know, you put on a pretty dress, you meet a guy, that's your future. But really, that was kind of what women had to do. So there is a really alarming kind of dichotomy between what we have now socially and what was going on in the 19th century, and it helps us to understand the stories a little bit better if we can contextualize them in time.
And as like terrible of a person as Bruno Bettelheim was, he still thought that stories were instructional for children because they taught them what real life, like you say,
right.
was going to be like.
Right, exactly. We didn't talk about that one. I'm sorry.
Oh, this is the ungrateful son who I actually sort of made into a daughter. But it's a wonderful story. It's one of the shorter Grimms, and it's about a paragraph or two long. And it's about a man who doesn't appreciate his father. And so he doesn't feed him. And so he's cursed to live with a toad on his head. And if he doesn't feed the toad like he didn't feed his father, it eats his face.
Yes.
So I decided they should share a tongue, and this is probably the most highly keyed, colored, mm-hmm. Drawing of the group, and one of my favorites. But, you know, I decided that she should sort of take on this green toad skin herself, and she was pretty nasty. And it was fun to think about, you know, a lot of the characters in the stories, as in the next slide with Little Red Cap, mm-hmm. take on a color as almost a type of clothing to represent who they are or what their moral center is sort of made of.
Is Little Red Cap nude here?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
Because in the original Little Red Cap, actually, she comes in and the wolf has her... present a striptease to him,
yes,
and
right.
she throws her clothing into the fire and then jumps into bed with him.
Right.
So the Grimm's brother is not quite that racy, but she does notice he has parts that grandma doesn't have. Mm-hmm. So I put him in a corset and flashing himself at Little Red Riding Hood, or Little Red Cap. But I wanted to show sort of how naive she was. So
right.
I thought she should be a little girl, naked and covered in red. And then this is the Little Red Cap and the grandmother after they've been eaten by the wolf.
Mm-hmm.
And it describes them coming out of every orifice of the wolf. But I had a lot of fun with the, you know, the environments, the patterned wallpaper and the little clawed hooves on the bed and the kind of bulging eyes of the wolf, who I really identified with the most in the story. And this is Donkey Skin, which is one of the nastier stories. It's one of two incest stories in the Grimms. And it's a story of a king whose wife is about to die, and she's pictured on the right, kind of deathly looking. And she says to him, "When I die, I want you to marry someone as blonde and beautiful as I am." So he decides to marry his daughter, who's pictured on the left, nude. And I gave him a donkey kind of headdress, and he also is flashing himself, but holding a kind of fetish stick, which is, in my mind, wound up with blonde hair. So she, the daughter, eventually flees, goes into hiding. And this is another very clear case of kind of the Grimms paying attention to details about clothing. In the next slide, she says to the father, "I'll only marry you if you can make me 3 dresses of the sun, moon, and stars, and a coat of every animal in the kingdom," thinking he can't do it, but he actually can. So she takes the clothing and goes into hiding, and of course hides in a tree, which is a common thing for women in the stories. And then eventually, in the next slide, becomes a chambermaid in the neighboring kingdom and blackens her face. But a lot of the women, I decided, should be wearing, they were such bold figures, probably because they were women's creations, whether they were villainesses or heroines. They really run the gamut, that I put so many of them in red. And it's kind of fun to look through the book, or when you see the show, there's kind of a melding of heroine and villainess and heroine and villainess and repetition of clothing and sometimes even portraits.
Right. Yeah, and I really love this story because it has this great fashion reference, and she uses her fashion again when she is in the other kingdom to kind of give a sense to the king that she is a princess. She's kind of sneaking off to balls wearing these magnificent gowns. So I was sad that this was cut from anthologies because of that incest thing, because it is a great fairy tale and really fashion related.
And this is Donkey Skin, and this is a wild... Sorry, that's the lettuce donkey. It's a wild story about magic lettuce, and people use the lettuce to turn in and out of donkeys. But in the end, I put this slide in because I wanted her wearing this. She becomes a queen after being a lowly peasant and a donkey, and retains her donkey teeth because she's evil and has betrayed the donkey prince. But I thought she should have this beautiful sort of lace collar on.
Yeah, I really love this one. I'd forgotten about the teeth thing.
The Bremen Town Musicians, which is one of the few really sweet stories in the Brothers Grimm.
I don't know this one, I have to admit.
It's a group of animals who are cast out by their humans and become a traveling band. Oh. And so it was fun to think about sort of how I wanted to almost dress animals. So the figure on the right is... I think it's a lion, and I wanted him wearing a long lion tunic. The figure on the left is obviously a donkey, but I thought he should kind of be in jail bait stripes. And then the rooster is in the back. So they form a traveling band and then eventually take over a robber's den and take all of their gold after jumping one on top of another to scare the robbers and convince them they're an animal of Satan. It's a sweet story. And that's the last drawing of Little Red Cap.
Oh, sorry. It's out of order.
Yeah. And then Rapunzel, who, when I thought about that story, it's such an odd story, and I didn't know it took its name from the Rapunzel lettuce that's growing.
That was something I learned too, yeah.
In the witch's garden. And so because Rapunzel is pregnant, she's craving this lettuce, and she tells her poor degenerate husband, who's sort of pathetic, to go and get her that lettuce. And so he ends up trading the lettuce for the as-being-born Rapunzel, who's coming out of Rapunzel's mother. there, and the sort of blonde hair becomes an umbilical cord. But I wanted to use the stripes of her outfit, mirror that in the stripes of the room, and create a sort of insane asylum kind of feeling to this story, which it really is.
Yeah, it is. And I didn't realize she was named after the plant either. It's not very original, really.
And poor Rapunzel, in my story, is an older woman who is not, I'd say, the Disney version of Rapunzel, has an R on her forehead, and the evil stepmother who takes her in and the prince are both climbing up her braids. But what's different in the original story is Rapunzel says, oh my, something about how she's gotten so much heavier to pull up, and it's because she's pregnant from the prince's visits. So that's how the evil stepmother catches on, that right. She's had other visitors.
Exactly.
And this is the scene when Rapunzel and her lover reunite in the desert. And I was looking at old illustrated books, period illustrated books of the Grimms in 19th century and Perrault, the century before. And so his blindness is cured by her tears, and her wretched children are there with her. So I put them upside down.
Yeah, and I found Rapunzel so interesting because she does get pregnant by the prince's, or with the prince's children, and have these twin babies. And then everybody's cast out into the forest. I guess the prince kind of casts himself out. But everyone gets cast out, and Rapunzel's off with her children. But there's never this explicit reference to the fact that she's pregnant. It's sort of glossed over. And in the Brothers Grimm tale, she just sort of has these children suddenly.
Magically, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, well, thank you, Natalie.
Thank you.
Thank you. We'll have time for questions later. And now we will move on to Kirsty's work. And I wanted to start with this fantastic picture of you taking a photograph, because as fantastic as Kirsty's work is, when she sent me images for this presentation, I love that you have documented your process so well also.
Yes, yeah, it was... It was something that I felt was really important, because in the very early stages of me embarking on this journey with the series, the one thing that became extremely apparent was that nobody believed it was real. living in an age of digital manipulation where this kind of work is put together very quickly, you know, with CGI and everything that we see in film as well, the fact that someone would be crazy enough to spend 5 months making one photograph just, you know, wasn't that accepted. So we began documenting how we created the photographs. At first it was just a keepsake, because so much work goes into the images before I actually record them with the camera. I mean, when I introduce myself, sometimes when I speak publicly about what I do, rather than call myself a photographer, I prefer to call myself an artist with a camera. Because it's about sort of 70% of what I do is the making and the creating of the work, and then it's assembled in front of the camera. So we wanted to capture that for people to understand the scale of it, really.
Yeah, and this was fascinating for me, because I had the good fortune of meeting Kirsty last summer when I was in the UK, and I had no idea how you worked, and she gave me just a little bit of a sense of how she sets up these really amazing sets and takes the photos. So we'll be seeing a little bit of her process kind of photo by photo in the future. But I also wanted to start because I think we're all inspired by other images, other fairy tale illustrations. And so tell us a little bit about your process, really how you started this project, Wonderland, and some of the images that initially inspired you.
Well, my work is quite different in the sense of the pieces that I create are not linked directly to fairy tales that exist. The series that I've been producing, Wonderland, for... It was 6.5 years to create 74 large-scale photographs. They are inspired by the books that my mother read to me as a child, but they are not a recreation of anything that already exists. So rather than linking directly, like your own work, to you know, certain characters, these are more sort of meditations, and I would call them sort of blurred hybrids. They're memories of the illustrations from the books that my mother read to me, but also the entire project is very, very heavy in emotion, because it is all born out of the grief for the loss of my mother. My mother passed away in 2008, quite suddenly, from a brain tumour. And she was an English teacher. And so literature was her life's great passion. And so our house was full of beautiful books. And when I talk about this relationship that I had with my mother when she would read to me, it was never in the sense of sort of twee bedtime stories. It was more, I always relate it to now that we live in this sort of era of social media, when you find something that excites you or inspires you, you know, a piece of music, a film, your instinct is to share. And this is what my mother's passion was with unusual books. So we had these beautiful books in the house, and I would come home from school and it would be like, I have this one, you've got to see this, and then we would share this. So after I lost her, I found myself sort of regressing back to those safe memories, because her losing her was so traumatic for me. I was unable to remember her in sort of those recent times. Mm-hmm. So my way of dealing with grief was really to link back to this safe memory, to remember the books that we shared. But then it became this journey that was very heavily underpinned with my adult grief and the emotions of that. So this book here, Moonlight and Fairyland, is actually quite a lesser known book. I didn't realise at all. It was only when I started searching back for it. And the illustrations in this one, they have heavily affected my work. The sort of the darkness, the midnight feel. Interestingly, with your work, I think with all of us, with fairy tales, you have this sort of twee Disney sense that people associate. But actually, when you go back to some of the depths and the hearts of photos, they're quite dark and, you know, sinister, or there's sadness there. And that's what I think comes through in my work too.
Absolutely, yeah.
So the illustration that you just saw in the previous one, this is an example of how these things would affect my work. So the previous slide, you had the prints with the midnight garden with the purples and the blues and the pinks. So this is how it can affect some of the costumes that I would produce. It's not a literal creation, but it's more kind of these fragments and memories that were inspired by those illustrations. So I took the concept of the midnight garden and then brought it into this costume, but then created the entire piece from flowers. So this king was kind of like an organic creature. Masquerade is another book that heavily inspired my series. It's different because it's not a fairy tale as such, but this was a very prominent book in the early 1980s. Growing up as a child, we had a copy of this in my house. And I think it's a really fascinating story, because obviously this was before the internet existed. And Kit Williams created this book of 15 extraordinary paintings where he hid codes into the work. And there's a great sense of play with this book where he'd hidden a hair in every image. A child, I was kind of obsessed going through the different pages. And then this one in particular drove me absolutely insane, because to a small child, trying to find that tiny hair in the corner of the picture, and I had this really vivid memory of sort of sitting there, pulling my hair out, desperate to find the hair, my father kind of chuckling, looking away. And this sense of play was something I wanted to put into my work. So in my series, I've taken the galleon ship, which is a metaphor for journey. The series of Wonderland is really kind of it's autobiographical. It's my personal journey through grief, reflected through this series of stories. So I wanted to take that concept of play that I'd loved so much as a child and put it in. So this sort of motif of a galleon will constantly reappear through the series. Again, here you sort of have it hidden in the jewellery and into the Queen's Key. It was just something that, I don't know, it was a very personal thing that a lot of people who now know the series really well will come up to me in a gallery and say, what are the galleons all about? Where does that come from? The thing that's so extraordinary about this book, Masquerade, was that it inspired a worldwide treasure hunt, because The author Kit Williams, as part of the reason for the codes in the book, was that they would lead somebody to a golden treasure that he'd hidden in the countryside in England. And with my own book, I don't know if you've got that in the slides coming up, but I've produced a book of this series, and like he had produced a treasure with his book, I've produced the bronze key that goes with the very special collector's edition version of this book. So it was the idea of having this really precious series of beautiful images, and then also linking back to that was something that felt really important to me. It was a great deal of work to be able to convince anyone to help me to produce it, but I'm very proud of it now it's been done. Yeah.
Did anyone ever find that treasure?
Yes, they did, but it's such a tragic story because the artist made the treasure hunt so complicated and so confusing that I think it actually took about 3 years. And the poor man had sort of these strange people turning up at his doorstep at 3 o'clock in the morning, begging him for clues. And this was before email. So he had sort of, you know, little post vans coming every day, dumping bin sacks of letters from Japan, America, all over the world. And it actually kind of drove him a bit to the edge. And he became a recluse afterwards because it was just too much for him.
Oh my gosh.
It's the most extraordinary story. And what finally happened was, I mean, it's terrible. There's a documentary about it. You could weep. There were two men who spent 2 years of their life basically ignoring their family and working on cracking the code. They cracked the code together, but in the same week as a man who happened to be a landlord of the ex-girlfriend of Kit Williams, who happened to let slip where the treasure was buried,
He
went off with a shovel at midnight the same week these guys cracked it and found it.
Oh, that's awesome.
So it's such a tragic story that these two guys had been working on it forever and then some landlord had overheard a story and went and found it.
Oh, that's so unfair.
Real life. Just like the fairy tale.
Yeah.
I know. It's an extraordinary tale and it's just always stayed with me. So I love the idea of doing that myself.
I'm going to have to look up that documentary.
Yeah, it's wonderful. It really is.
At least now I'm prepared for it. So let's talk a little bit more about your inspirations. You sent me a lot of really lovely types of inspiration, one of which, of course, is art historical.
Yeah. History of art is just so key in what I do. It's funny, when I'm interviewed, people often say to me one of the first few questions is, what photographers inspire you? And actually, I rarely look at photography at all. I'm far more inspired by painting. And it was a really early love of mine that I've always continued and has always been very much part of my life. So with my work, often when I'm looking at perspective of taking a photograph, I'm thinking compositionally in the eye of a painter rather than a photographer. So people like Gustav Klimt really, really inspire me, you know, sort of raising the camera up above, extending proportions. In my series, the models are rarely ever actually human height because I'm always sort of putting them on plinths and extending their dresses. The costumes can be up to 9 foot long because everything is real that's put in front of the camera. I don't manipulate it in the computer afterwards. So surface decoration and colour, these are all things that really inspire me that have come from my training in fashion because I was a fashion designer for 10 years.
Right. Mm-hmm. And I think, here's another great
pre-Raphaelite. Massive influence. You know, the relationship with nature, the importance of nature is something that is very key in my work. After losing my mother, I'm not a religious person, my family aren't, but I felt this overwhelming bond with nature afterwards. And because my mother wasn't buried in the UK, there was nowhere for me to go. So I always say that the sort of the woods became my church. It was the place where I would go and feel connected to her. So nature is very, very key in my work, yeah.
And how do you find these settings?
Well, this is, again, the funny thing. Everybody thinks that the series was shot all over the world, and actually it was all shot within about 40 minutes of my house.
Okay, yeah.
And I sort of jokingly have said for years, I live in Wonderland, you know, aren't I lucky to have all of this around me? And then unbelievably and sort of stupidly, it was only recently that I discovered that Lewis Carroll actually lived and worked right near where I'm based, literally sort of a 15-minute drive, which is quite ironic, really.
Yeah, did that come up because of the anniversary of Alice's Adventures in Wonderland? I know there was so much based
no,
on...
No, literally, it was just a friend of mine, actually, who lived in Canada, who's also an artist. He moved there and wrote to me saying, I'm now living sort of on the doorstep of where Lewis Carroll was, and I suddenly realised that so was I.
Oh, that's really fantastic. Yeah.
This is another example of, you know, artists affecting my work, the work of Andy Goldsworthy. Again, the relationship with nature, like I was saying, using nature to create the pieces in my work is something that I do a great deal, always working with flowers and leaves and sort of, you know, the gifts that we're given with nature. Alphonse Services Mucha as well. I'm really inspired by Art Nouveau. Like I say, a lot of it is never literal. You can never pinpoint it down to a specific thing, but through training in it, it's something that's always been in my mind. So these kind of decorative things and like the hair being translated into my images, it's just all background. I never look at photography or modern influences that much mm-hmm. in the work that I do. So these are, as I explained earlier, I the large amount of the work that I do is creating the costumes and the sets for the things that are in my photographs. So in the book that I have just brought out of the series, I've spent a great deal of time making sure that all the costumes that I made were documented because they're incredibly precious to me. These two are, this one is the Queen Centurion and this one is the Ghost Swift, which was made from hundreds of tiny paper cup butterflies that took 3 months. That one took 3 months to make, and I think that one took 2 months to make. And I designed and embroidered all the lace for that as well. So, pretty.
It's so fascinating to see these kind of on their own too.
Yeah.
And then we have a McQueen reference here, but also another image using one of your beautiful.
Yeah. Well, ensembles. This is the thing. I mean, when people say to me who are your greatest influences, I would say actually McQueen is one of mine. I worked with him for a year as an intern, and he more than anyone has inspired me more in life. His sort of love of decay and beauty and nature and all that kind of darkness. It was interesting what you were saying with the fairy tales about women often hiding in the trees. What you were saying, that's something that, I don't know, maybe that subconsciously come through with the character that I produced for this one, which is called The Last Door of Autumn. It's something that I returned to a lot in my series as well. So, mm-hmm. yeah. Again, a sort of a little homage here. This was my character, the White Queen. This costume was made from 240 wooden fans from China with Balinese shadow puppets on the front, which were kind of like these locking characters, sort of creating like a barrier to her body. Again, it very much inspired by McQueen's work, the idea of taking sculptural forms. For me, the idea of wearable art is right at the heart of what I do, and it's why I studied fashion. And I think the sort of the horror of when you're a fashion student, you get to create all these elaborate things, and then you enter the real world.
Right.
You can't wear that down the road. So for me, the absolute joy of being able to produce this work and to make the costumes in it, because people say to me, why don't you get a stylist? Why don't you get a costume maker to do this for you? But the truth is, this is the joy of it for me.
Right. It just wouldn't be the same.
Also, a great influence on my work is religious iconography, tribal references. I'm fascinated by the human extremes. With all my work, the characters that you see, I mean, more is more, that's for sure. I always push them as far as I physically can. And I think historically, it's something that is really, really fascinating. And it's a lost art now. And I'm sure with, the fairy tales, when you've been going through them, often sometimes it's the men that are more elaborate than the women, that you've got these sort of pompous characters with layers and layers of amazing clothes. And it's just something that I want to put into my work and I find really fascinating. Mm-hmm. So I'm always relating back to that. With the women that are in my scenes, I'm fascinated about the way of women are sort of put on a pedestal in iconography, and sort of the decorative elements of surrounding them with flowers and the layers and layers of detail. It's something that I always do with my work. And my hair and makeup artist, Elbie Van Eden, who's here, she has the patience of a saint, because whenever we're building a character together, often with some of her other clients, when she does high fashion, you know, it's sort of less is more. And I'm just sort of sitting there saying, like, yellow, blue, trowel it on. Can we have some glitter? That's definitely not big enough. I want some more. You know, that is that sort of amazing thing that you get with this, where there's just no holding back. So this is the headdress that I made for Gaia, Birth of an End. And this one took about 2.5-3 months. Oh. All of this is pieces that I bought back from Tibet, India, as well as, I mean, the thing that's quite funny is that I will work with anything, and the series is huge and it's all self-funded. So there are elements within it that are actually made from the most hilarious things. Like in there are several jumpers from a charity shop. So it's kind of like taking all this texture and building it, and just more, bigger. And this headdress was actually so big, we had to wire it to the ceiling of my studio because it was so heavy.
Oh, my
gosh. No human being could actually wear it, because it was, you'd just crush your head. So, yeah.
What do you do with these objects after?
They're all in my studio. My studio is just like the most fun place in the world to just go in. And there's just all this stuff there. So, again, this is why I wanted to document the amount of work that goes into the photographs.
Yeah.
It's vast.
Yeah, yeah, it's really fascinating to think about.
Yeah, so that's the final piece. And this one is, it comes in three sizes, but the intended size, this is at 2 meters high. So it's, you know, kind of close to what you're looking at right now.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a huge, huge piece. But I think also what's interesting is that I don't like to be called a fashion photographer. Some people misunderstand what I'm about and what I do. And, you know, here, quite clearly, I put all that work into the headdress, and yet I've chopped an enormous amount off of it. But
right.
For me, it was more about the power of emotion with this image. And so even though you've invested all this work, you have to step back from it and say, this image is not about the garment. It's not about, I want to show the fact I've spent months on this. It's there. It's a part of it, but it's creating a character.
Right. And the fact that this completely fills up the screen, you know, you don't have the space around the larger headdress makes a huge impact.
Yeah.
Oh, I love this section. This is Victorian Photoshop, right? That was the folder name.
So this is something that I always love to talk about, because, like I said earlier, we were saying people initially thought my work was all Photoshopped and it was created in a computer. And sort of the joke is, I'm not a very technical person, so I wouldn't actually know how to do that anyway. The thing that really excites me and inspires me about early photography is when I give lectures very specifically about this part of my work, is what I call a truthful lie. It's where, yes, the camera is the truth, it is recording what's in front of you, but what I loved about sort of, you know, the Victorian era was the fact that they sort of set up, you know, these staged images, you know, even whether it was wedding photographs or family portraits, and then this one is Lewis Carroll's, I think it's his grandchildren. I didn't even know that he took pictures. And there's a whole sort of series of these amazing, playful pictures where he sort of got them just like up in the loft of one of his houses, all dressing up. And that for me is exactly what lies at the heart of what I do. It's a truthful lie. It's building a story in front of a camera, creating this fantasy. And particularly in the early years, before I was able to sort of spend more on the project, often our garments were just made from complete rubbish. We would capture the image and then it would all fall apart afterwards and could never exist again. Mm-hmm. And I quite liked that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm. So these are perfect examples of it. If anyone's seen the film The Piano, it's a huge influence on me, and it was a real light bulb moment that I had years ago when the film first came out. And there's this scene where the main character is married off to this guy in New Zealand. She's sort of sent off on a boat they've never met before. And then to sort of solidify their union, they have this fake wedding photograph taken. And it's right out in the jungle. So it's a tropical storm. It's thundering down with rain. The poor woman is sort of shoved in half of a wedding dress, so it's not even a full proper dress, it just has strings at the back. And then she's kind of stuck in front of this fake backdrop with a bit of a red curtain, and everything is filthy from the rain and the mud, and he's trying to comb the mud out of his hair. The whole thing's a calamity, and then they're just sort of sitting there utterly miserable having their photograph taken. And I love the fact that it was all assembled outside and in the woods. And again, it was a light bulb moment for me, because I think when you're a young photographer and you're starting out, you think you have to have a studio, you have to have all this equipment. And of course, this was just a facade built in the woods, and that is exactly what became the heart of what I do.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And we'll get to some of those. I think this is our clip, and I might skip over it for time's sake, since you did a great job describing it. And this is what I wanted to get to. I love that you can really see the process.
So this is my truthful lie. This is exactly what I was just talking about, and this is... compared to some of the big elaborate scenes that I've done, this is a really small one that was just produced in my studio back in the UK. So I wanted to create this really elaborate character that was linked to the illustrations in The Snow Queen. And it literally was just sort of, you know, getting all these flowers and ivy and then building this micro set in front of the camera. And then that was it. And then the framing of the picture, you would never have known that this was what was behind it all. So it's creating that physical illusion. And that's the final piece. So all of that was entirely real. You know, the coat that I handmade, the coat, the wig, all of it. And what I do is I will mix fresh flowers with the artificial ones in the costume and just blend everything together into this really highly elaborate portrait. Another example of... So that was a very simple one, and then this is one of the most elaborate ones that I did, where for the finale, well, the penultimate scene of my series, there's a character, the main protagonist, Katie, she leaves the world that she's been travelling through, and sort of as a reference to Narnia, she exits her world through this huge elaborate door in the woods. So obviously there was no elaborate door in the woods near where I live. So I decided that I had to make the door, and I had to make it the most extraordinary, most beautiful door that I ever could, because it was my goodbye to this deeply personal project. So when people see the finished photograph and then I tell them that I actually made the entire wall and door that the model is standing next to, their jaws kind of drop off. And this took two months to make the door. So this was just... progress slides of it being put together. So all hand-painted, hand-cast. It was quite a body of work. So I think.
And did you have to make this out of relatively lightweight material too, so you could drag it through the woods?
The thing about my shoots is that they nearly kill us every time. I have a tiny team. It's funny, over the years as the series has become more well known, I'm contacted by people all over the world saying, you know, I want to come and assist you, can I come and help you? But the series is deeply, deeply personal. It's incredibly private. And when I first started this, there was just a small little group of friends that were doing it, and we have remained the same throughout. So for that reason, it means there's a few of us. We work in very remote locations, and I'm very protective over nature. I don't wish to disturb the landscapes that we're working in. So I don't want to turn up like some rock star with 50 people smashing the undergrowth. So in this instance, the door weighed a ton, even though we made it as light as we could, and it took 16 hours to get the set to the woods, set up, the photograph done, back down, and done in one day. So there was only about, I think there was about six of us. That was it. And the location was really far away from the road. So we were kind of like dragging all this stuff. You know, we were dead before we even took the picture.
Here's some of the dragging.
So this is us building the door in the woods. This was on a day when the BBC News actually came and filmed us as well. So it was double the pressure because we were racing against the clock, racing against the English weather, which always destroys everything. And then we also had the BBC News kind of breathing down our necks as well. So it was a very high pressured shoot. Yeah. And so this is us creating our snow. So again, what I wanted to do in the final scene was that it was meant to be a marriage of seasons. It was spring and winter meeting at the same point. Mm-hmm. Again, as a homage to Narnia, the idea of on the other side of the door there was going to be snow. So we had to make snow in spring. So it was 100 bags of flour. I won't even talk about how hard it was to get 100 bags of flour to this remote location. There was a lot of swearing. and then we had studio pulp. We had all these things. So this is us creating our snow. It looks like a murder scene. And then this is the final image. So everything you see there is entirely real. And this is the thing that nobody can really get their heads around. And even the light, we were blessed with the most extraordinary natural light. We didn't take a lighting rig. So, and I think that's something that's quite exciting about the project, is that we spend all this time like making all this beautiful stuff, but then you were utterly at the mercy of the English weather, and you kind of take all this precious stuff out there and you just have to let it go. You have to deal with it. If it snows, if it rains, you take it on. And so that was a real gift that we got that amazing light that day. Yeah.
And what's interesting is when I met Kirsty last summer, she gave me this lovely little book of a lot of her images, and I was meeting with the book designer from Yale University Press the next day, and I was kind of updating him on my travels, and I showed him this image, and I told him the story about the flower, and he just stared at it for about 5 minutes. I still don't think he believes me, so yeah. I wish he were here to hear the whole thing.
Yeah, okay, so going into details. So obviously at the exhibition we have three pieces. There's Once Upon a Time, The Ghost Swift, and The Storyteller, which has become the key image that has been shown a lot for this piece. This is an example of the detail that I'll go into for the pictures. Mm-hmm. So this was in the final story, you'll see that there's a girl lying on a sea of books. This is us getting her in position. What I did with all of those books was that I soaked them in buckets of tea and coffee for sort of 2 weeks and would go out in the garden and kick them around every now and then and hose them down again. It was all about making everything as authentic as possible. So it was actually one of the very, very first images in the series. It's the opening image to the project, Once Upon a Time. So it was about the concept of a girl kind of falling into a story.
Mm-hmm. Mm. And I love that she's actually kind of in this pit too, which I hadn't thought about because that could so easily kind of be done by lighting or by effects, but she really is in this pit.
Yeah. And I really let nature lead me. I spend a great amount of time location scouting, and sometimes I will just come across the most extraordinary thing and that will be it. And on that day, I'd found this sort of fantastic pit and decided, well, this is it. I'm just going to be throwing my model in there later. So, yeah. Going on to other things that influenced me, the Cockney Fairies were, I just think it's just one of the most amazing stories. And again, it goes back to that kind of element of sort of darkness and lies, which I love. The fact that these two women maintained sort of till they were like 80 that these fairies were real. I love the fact that they just lied through their teeth about all of it. It's something that I think is wonderful. So this idea of creating magic with the most basic of materials, because it was just paper, that really inspired the beginnings of my character, the Ghost Swift, and wanting to create my own sort of amazing mythical lady from the original old botanical illustrations from the Victorian era. It was something that was the sort of the starting block for that.
And I love that you brought this in too, because I remember being fascinated by this story as a little girl, and I had completely forgotten about it. And then it came up as I was researching fairy tale fashion, but I couldn't figure out how to work it in.
Here it is. And it's a tale that my mother told to me. And again, it's like a real personal thing that I always remember, and me sort of delighting in the fact that, you know, they sort of tried to pull the wool over everybody's eyes and then just so fiercely light again and again. That was me. So what I did was I went and got all these huge sort of old historical volumes and then blew up the moths and the beetles and the butterflies from that, and then laboriously hand cut forever them out. So this is us building the set. So again, going back to what I was saying about a truthful lie, making sure that everything is hand done. The thing about my work is that actually all the photographs are very, very big. When you see them in a gallery, they are up to 2 meters. So I think if any of this stuff is done in digital manipulation, I don't know, you see the flaws, you can tell the light's not quite right, and it's all a bit, it's unbelievable. True. And but again, like I say, the joy for me is just physically doing it. So I'm always because I have such a tiny crew, I don't sort of sit on a golden cushion and point. You know, it's me in there.
Wearing your wellies. I love
covered,
that.
Covered in mud and, you know, going for it. Yeah. So this is LB, our hair and makeup artist, working on the model. We do a lot of work on the model on set, so we will do preliminary work. But then once we're there, it's a lot of kind of hand painting and adding more in. And then that's shooting the picture. And for me, you know, documenting the behind the scenes, I just adore this photograph because it really shows the reality of the work. They're wonderful memories, and it was something that was really important that when I produced the book of the series, that was documented in it. So again, this is a close-up of it. Enormous, enormous amount of work. And then that's one of the finished images. And this is what I do with my characters within the series, is that emotion is incredibly important to me in what I do. I think that's why it used to annoy me when people would sort of call me a fashion photographer, because all of this comes from a very, very deep personal place. And so with the characters that I create, what I will often do is I will photograph them far back so that there is this kind of sense of scale, and they're in their setting and they're in their environment, and you believe them as a character, you don't question it. And then what I would like to do afterwards is that I then bring the camera in as close as possible, like the previous portrait, where there's a portrait of that character and you have a sense of connection with them, that there is an emotion there and a meaning, and it's not just this kind of like wanting to create a character that no one can relate to. So I often do that with the series.
Yeah, and people have been so struck by your work in fairy tale fashion. I always bring it up in every introduction that I give, and people get very close to it. They definitely have emotional reactions to it.
Oh, that's good too.
And I think this is our last creation series, but I really love this one because this is one
the glamour.
Of the show. Yeah.
So this is me. So this is in the early days before I even had a studio. So when I first began this series, I was actually still working as a fashion designer. So I had this sort of ridiculous life where I would be going into the city, commuting for 4 hours a day, working as a fashion designer, and then my every sort of waking moment apart from that, so the evenings, the weekends, I was obsessively creating the project. So this picture is from 2010, before I'd even left my job, and so this is me at about 1 o'clock in the morning in my kitchen with stacks and stacks and stacks of stolen bluebells, threading them very glamorously on a towel with a holy old jumper. preparing the headdress for the storyteller, which you will see, I presume, coming through. So again, this is me and LB, hair and makeup artist, slaving away. I think this was taken at about 3 o'clock in the morning, because a lot of the stuff that I do, I work with fresh natural materials. You have no time. You can't pre-make this stuff. So this was the night before the shoot that we were frantically making the headdress, threading tons and tons of fresh bluebells that were still wet from the fields. To make the finished headdress. So that's it there. And then this is us creating the throne that the storyteller will be sitting on, which was made from a whole collection of old books, which had an amazing story behind them themselves, because my assistant there, her great-grandmother's house had been left to rack and ruin for years, and they had this old book collection that she had had from sort of as a child, where she'd been given books as gifts throughout her whole life until she died and was an old lady. So that there was this amazing collection, and we were given them because they were all rotting and been left in the house. So we wanted to create this sort of palatial throne made of all these old rotting books.
I love it. They got a new life, memorialized.
Well, this is exactly it. I mean, they were either left to rot or we made something extraordinary out of them, because some people's reactions when they see the photograph, like, how can you do that to those books? But they were kind of dying, so we wanted to make something amazing with them. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and they were all over 120 years old, so it was really authentic.
Wow.
And that's preparing the set. So again, when people see the picture, they don't believe that it's real, so it's really great to
sort of get
this.
Until they see you carrying that headdress.
She was extraordinary. I mean, there are some moments in producing the series where, you know, people say to me, why do you do this? Why do you spend, you know, months going through hell to produce one single image? And for me, it's so hard to put into words what it's like to stand there in that moment where these flowers will only bloom for 2 weeks of the year. They're kind of like a natural phenomenon anyway. And to be there and to have this in front of you, your own extraordinary creation that maybe five people can see, it's the adrenaline. It's why I do it. It's why I get out of bed in the morning. It's such an amazing feeling. It really is.
And such amazing results, yeah, too.
Yeah, so this one is a forgotten tale. So again, it's what I was saying earlier about you have that far back of the character in the location, and then you bring the camera in to get that impact of, you know, you understand who she is, mm-hmm. that there's, you know, she has a personality to her.
And this is what's in the fairy tale fashion exhibition.
And the books that you see around her neck were actually prayer books that were given to the grandmother when her husband died. They actually had like tiny clippings from his obituary in the newspapers. So when I discovered this collection, these books were obviously incredibly important and very precious. So we decided to make a necklace from those books that would be worn across the heart of the model as a sort of mark of respect for us being given these books. So always putting this into the work.
And here you are surrounded just by casual. Some of your beauties. Yeah. I thought this would be a nice place to end, showing off a lot of your images and fantastic pieces that you've made.
My studio doesn't always look like that. But when I completed the series, I wanted to take a photograph where I sort of brought together the two worlds. I brought together the photographs and the reality, the costumes, the whole thing together as a sort of a memory of it all existing together in one moment, because I don't think I will ever produce something quite on this scale again. It has, you know, nearly killed me, if I'm honest. But yeah, that was sort of my final sort of goodbye to it all. Yeah.
Fantastic. Well, thank you both so thank much. You. And we do have a few audience questions. For Kirsty, someone has asked how you find your team, their volunteers, and do you pay for everything or do you have an investor?
I have never had an investor. And this is something that it's a really common question that a lot of people ask me. And I get a great many emails from people saying, I'd love to do what you do, but I don't have any money and I can't fund it. Well, the fact is that when I started this series, I had absolutely nothing, and I was grabbing things out of skips and buying bits from DIY stores using chicken wire and paper mache, and it was all scratched out of absolutely nothing. And I use nature a great deal, as you can see from the photographs. I use leaves and flowers and things that I had access to, and I think that where there's a will, there's a way, and that is really how the series was born. I have never had an investor. I just wanted to make it happen. So I just forced myself as best I could with what I had. With regards to a team, when I first started, like I said, I began just with my poor, long-suffering husband, my amazing hair and makeup artist, Elvie, who it's something that I always talk about as a photographer, that I think in the photography industry, I find it quite strange that people, they chop and change their hair and makeup artists between shoots like anything, like they're not important. And I find it quite strange because in working with LB over all these years, you create a bond and a genuine understanding of each other, which means you work quicker, you grow with each other, and you know, you're not afraid to sort of push each other. I mean, when I did that Gaia Birth of an End photograph, I think Elby ended up spending 6 hours on the makeup for that. And I was sort of there going, more, 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 more. And, you know, instead of stomping out saying, I never want to see you again, she was like, okay, let's do this. Because we cared about the work, you know, it was personal. So in the beginning, that we were all just friends working for nothing. We had nothing. We were just doing it for the passion. That was mm-hmm. it. So, and we've carried on like that. I've never changed.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
So we have, I think, a very legitimate but tough question, which is why encourage fairy tales? And they mention fairy tales describing women as weak victims, evil stepmother, bringing in witches, men as wolves, oafs, fops. Natalie, do you want to speak to that?
Yeah, I think this is something that for me was the most interesting part of reading about the history of the fairy tales. That yes, though, and Linda Nochlin writes an essay for the book that I made about Little Red Cap, but addresses this sort of, yes, some of these tales are proto-feminist, but they do represent realities of life at the time, so better not to sort of gloss over what they really were. But they were, they're interesting as tales written by and collected primarily from women, because they are aspirational. And it's been interesting to talk with Jack about this, because throughout the history of fairy tales and tales, the idea of transformation was the key way to enable women and give them power. So I'm actually starting a new project with the fairy tale scholar of The Sorcerer's Apprentice. And in them, women really aren't present until the end. And I was asking Jack about that, because they began as tales where women shape-shifted. And he said when really Christianity came about, these tales stopped involving women and transformation because it became too threatening of an idea for men. But that's really sort of the source of, I think, most of the stories. And I think it's a, you know, a kind of a juggling act of how to represent life at the time, but also how to create roles for women that are, that do involve some sort of shifting in society. Because this was a time when power structures and gender structures, the bourgeois was coming about, everything was changing a little bit. So I don't, I mean, they are of their time, but there are some of the stories which are hilarious about women who outsmart men and kings and turn them into donkeys or fools or drug them. And there's a certain sense of power of women being able to portray, you know, heroines or princesses, but also evil figures too.
I completely agree with you. I mean, I think actually looking at your work, there's a real sense of strength. There's no twee Disney sweetness about it. And with my work in the early days when the series was just sort of beginning to be discovered, it's quite funny because you sort of find people writing about it saying all these, you know, these weird, strange models. And what I used to take real pride in was that the any images that I produce in mind, we're looking at the religious iconography and the tribal images, I want the women in my images to have strength and power. And I feel that any of the sort of the heroines in my work radiate that. There's no weakness. There's often real directness and strength and almost threat in some of it. And I think that's something that is actually at the heart of quite a lot of, you know, the earlier original fairy tales, rather than sort of the diluted things that we're used to now. So actually, I think it's quite empowering.
And in art, fairy tales have been claimed by women as a tool of subversion and to represent this burgeoning feminism. And they've been recast. Think about Angela Carter and her stories and what can be done with the fairy tales. And, you know, if we think that it's obscene that a wolf seduces a young girl and makes her do a striptease, like, let's just think about Donald Trump and what's going on today. Our world is pretty surreal.
Yeah.
Kirsty, this is actually a question that I've had as well. How did you come about naming your photos for the Wonderland series?
Well, it's something that is kind of ironic because the title of the series is so simple and it seems to refer to a book. And obviously people will be forgiven for hearing the title Wonderland and think, oh, it's to do with, you know, Lewis Carroll's tale. But when I first began this project, I was working. It was 5 years ago, and I thought it was going to be a small summer project in memory of my mother. And really, that title was just a sort of as an umbrella for expect the unexpected. And then as the series developed and the photographs began this journey, something that I hadn't preempted at all, I mean, it almost had a life of its own, suddenly a narrative began to form that became autobiographical. And these characters had a journey and a purpose, and there was a story to what I was producing. And therefore, the images became more and more laden with emotion and meaning. And so that was something that I really began to think very deeply about when I was naming them. And towards the end of the series, you know, they really become lengthy and, you know, the fate of fallen memories, the secret locked in the roots of a kingdom. And when I write the diary entries that accompany the photographs, all of that meaning is explained. And really, it's just about the lyricism of fairy tales and the, sort of the idea of making you want to know why, you know, the secret locked in the roots of a kingdom. What is this image about? Why, you know, what is it referring to? So I always wanted people to maybe go back and read and understand the depth of what's behind the work. Mm. Yeah.
The next question, what is your favorite piece in the show? I don't know, Kirsty, if you've seen the exhibition
well,
yet.
Well, sadly, I'm going to see it tomorrow.
Okay,
I was
meant to see it today.
So
you're excused. Your pieces can be your favorite in the show.
My section, which I was just breathtaking, I thought was breathtaking, were the little red cap, little red riding hood images, because they were so striking and almost like it's so ingrained in our visual culture. We see a red bonnet and we know that it refers to that fairy tale, mm-hmm. where maybe some of the others are less or more obscure or more related to the narrative. But those images and also the breadth of the way that artists and designers have interpreted that form was really interesting to me.
Yeah, that's actually one of my favorite sections too. Whenever I do tours, we have two sets of doors that you can use to enter the gallery, but I always like to go through the Little Red Riding Hood doors. For me, my favorite pieces change pretty much every day. But at the moment, I have a favorite pairing, which is two pieces by Tom Brown that are representing the tale Snow White and Rose Red, which is a different Snow White from the one we're most familiar with. It's about two sisters who are named after the rose bushes that grow in their mother's garden. So Rose Red is wearing a Tom Brown suit that has this great applique of red roses that's kind of scattered and chaotic. And Rose Red, although both of the sisters are sweet, Rose Red was meant to be the slightly feistier sister. So I like that there's this kind of chaotic element to the roses on this particular piece. And that is next to a Tom Brown man suit that has a spectacular headpiece by Stephen Jones that's kind of a cage, but it's in the shape of a bear. And because it's a cage, you can still see the human head beneath very clearly, but then it has this kind of bear outline. And the story ends with a bear who transforms back into a prince and marries Snow White, and Rose Red marries his brother. So this particular Stephen Jones headpiece has this real sense of metamorphosis that I really love and just happened to be part of this Tom Brown collection. So lucky me that that exists. And then we'll end with one question. What is some advice for a budding artist or photographer? If both of you would like to tackle that.
I think it's something I'm often asked, and I think one of the best pieces of advice I've ever had was in 2010. I had a real tough love meeting with an art curator. It was brilliant. He absolutely destroyed me. And his advice has stayed with me ever since. And he was of an age where really the internet was not of any relevance to him. He was working very high-end art. The idea of social media and the competition that it creates amongst young artists didn't affect him. So there was I with the very first few pieces of Wonderland, where I'd realised I was beginning to make characters, but they weren't fully resolved at all. And I think that's where, in the early days, people were confusing my work with fashion, because it would be something beautiful in the woods, you know, flowers, etc., but it wasn't a hard sort of lyrical character. And he was looking at the pieces and he was saying, it's great, it's lovely. What would you do if you stopped this rat race, if you stopped thinking you had to produce work quickly and run this race looking sideways to all your contemporaries? And if he said, step out of the shoes of the people that, you know, may be looking at your work online or making you work quickly, forget that. Imagine standing in the shoes of someone in a gallery looking at your work who wants to commit to that piece, who wants to own it for the next 20 years, hand it down in their you know, for generations in their family. Why should they believe in you? Why should they connect with the work that you are doing? What is the message in what you are producing? Does this final one piece that you're producing resonate? Does it say who you are? Is it full of the passion that is inside you? And there was me sort of looking at my pictures going, well, no. And so he said, stop the madness, step away. Do not go on the internet for a year. Step away, produce maybe 6 pieces instead of 40 or, you know, whatever you're normally banging out. Make work slowly, put everything into it that you have in your heart, and then come back and say, does it answer the questions that I've given you? And that's exactly what I did. I went cold turkey for a year and was kind of sort of sitting in my living room sewing things, thinking, will anyone remember Wonderland when I come back? You know, I was terrified that I'd made this decision, and I produced the White Queen trilogy, which was the costume that took months with all the fans. And when I released those images after almost a year, terrified, sort of looking at my computer thinking everyone's going to be, who is this? I don't even remember or care. It was the complete opposite. People were suddenly enraptured and were like, okay, this is a different thing. Mm-hmm. And that was when everything changed and I started speaking with people on a different level and people took me more seriously. And I think you just have to be authentic. It sounds cheesy, but you have to be you and do the best that you can.
Wow. Well, I was going to say just you have to believe in what you do, but I think that's what you said, and have a really tough skin, and opinions and critics and other artists and other people, everyone has an opinion, and you have to listen to yourself, keep your ears open, but do exactly what you want to do and keep doing it. And another piece of good advice I think I had in graduate school was don't complain and don't explain.
Well, I think it says a lot that people came to me and said, you have to see Natalie's work, you have to see Kirsty's work. It was really word of mouth that brought me to both of you, and I'm so thankful that you're here tonight. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Colleen.
Thanks.